Hey Parkside, welcome to worship. Just one announcement today. Next Sunday from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m., we're going to have another barbecue. We had so much fun at our last barbecue that we decided, let's just do another one, eat some more hot dogs, some hamburgers, enjoy the fellowship and the time that we have together. So next Sunday, let's do that again. We just ask that you bring your own drink again and bring your own chair again. And that way we're going to stay COVID compliant and keep everybody healthy while we're enjoying each other. So next Sunday, put that on your calendar. Well, right now I am just a little ways down from the church at the Beaverton Veterans Memorial. Love coming to memorials, love to see the history, love to see how we honor those who have given the ultimate sacrifice for their country. I'm very much a patriot, I'm sure you are too. I had a short stint in the Air Force and my dad served as in the Army. And then both of my grandfathers were in World War II, both serving, one in Normandy, one in Italy. So it's I've got quite the patriotic background in my family. So I have very much a love of country. Well, as we get ready to worship today, keep that idea in mind. What are the things in this life that keep us focused on the things that matter? Love is definitely one. Freedom is another. That's what gives value to life. And as you listen to the sermon today, keep that in mind.
You called me from the grave by name. You called me out of all my shame. I see the old is passed away, the new has come. Now
I Morning, Parkside. Thanks for joining me on this holiday weekend, 4th of July. I can't believe we're already here. In fact, I heard somebody say the other day we're 100 some odd days. We're a little over 100 days into this pandemic, which is hard to believe. Again, I know I've said this before. It's probably like a broken record. I never thought we would still be meeting like this virtually, you know, on the 4th of July. But here we are. And so I want to thank you for your faithfulness in terms of watching the Sunday messages on video, for attending Zoom meetings, for your faithful giving. I mean, I'm so grateful for our church and for our church family and how we have persevered through this time, through this season. So thanks for taking some time to join us here on this July 4th weekend. I'm excited about this series, to be honest with you. I'm excited that for the next 7 weeks, I get to partner with Norm and Larry and Roger, and we're gonna do a deep dive into seven churches that the Apostle John was commissioned to write by Jesus here in the book of Revelation. And the reason I'm excited is because not only is it a practical series for any time, but especially for now, it really does fit where we're at right now, that what we're living through during this season of unrest and a pandemic. And let me just kind of lay the foundation for this entire series. You see, over the last few weeks, Roger and I, along with our church council, I mean, we've been talking and we've been reading. We've been talking with other churches, and we've been reading, you know, Oregon Health Authority and the World Health Organization and you know, medical people. I mean, if it's in print and has to do with the pandemic and how to safely reopen, we've read it. If it's been talked about, we've heard it. I mean, we've spent the last few weeks just digesting as much as we can, so that when we do open, that we will do so in a healthy, physical way. We want to make sure that what the environment that you walk into on our first Sunday back is as healthy physically as it can possibly be. So we're thinking about things like social distancing. How's that going to work, right? Hand sanitizers. How many hand sanitizing stations do we need? Face coverings, mask versus no mask, whether or not we're going to sing. That's a big discussion. Just know we may not sing when we come together. Limited entrances and exits, right? Come in one door and have to leave another door. Contact tracing, right? Making sure we know who's a part of our service so we can report if someone does, heaven forbid, come down with COVID. Temperature checks, we're looking at that. Whether or not we're going to do coffee and donuts. And if we do, it's probably going to be a situation where you don't get your own coffee. We're going to have to get it for you and limited attendance. So all this stuff, we're juggling all this stuff because we want to make sure that when we open up, it is as healthy as it can possibly be. But even beyond that, with this series, what this series really goes right along with that, because this series is all about asking the question, how can Parkside, As we reopen, how can Parkside do so from a healthy spiritual standpoint? What do we need to do? So as we open back up, we're not behind the eight ball in terms of our spiritual growth and our spiritual focus. How do we maintain a healthy spiritual environment? Because when we open up, it's not going to be business as usual. It's not going to be back to normal. When we open up, there's still going to be a pandemic. There's still going to be social unrest. There's still going to be, all this fighting going on among, all the different, from a political standpoint, all the different parties out there. It's not going to be easy to do church in the midst of what we're going to open up to. And so we want to make sure that when we open up, that we know exactly what we're about, that we know exactly what the main thing is, what our focus needs to be. And really, that's what. John wanted to accomplish as he was given these seven letters by Jesus. It was all about getting these churches back on track. Because just like our church, right, we're trying to maintain a ministry presence in the midst of everything that's going on. These seven churches had been weakened by wave after wave of suspicion and criticism and complaints, attacks, persecution, right? So they were weak. Many of them were hurting. They were lost. They didn't know what to do. They were looking for leadership. They were looking for guidance. And unfortunately, their leader, right, the apostle John that really had helped kind of steer these churches, he's nowhere to be found. Because he himself has been battered by wave after wave of persecution, and now he finds himself exiled. He's actually been banished to an island, again, off the coast of Ephesus, about 40 miles off the coast, and it's the island of Patmos. And so it's on this island where John is given a vision. Jesus shows up, and he commissions John to write this incredible book that we call Revelation. And he's going to write this book that's going to include these letters to these seven churches. In fact, let me read from Revelation chapter 1. Revelation chapter 1, verse 4. We read these words. This letter is from John to the seven churches in the province of Asia. So this letter, this book of Revelation, he's writing it to these seven churches. Grace and peace to you. From the one who is, who always was, and who is still to come, right? And that's God. From the sevenfold spirit before his throne, and from Jesus Christ. He is a faithful witness to these things, the first to rise from the dead, and the ruler of all the kings of the world. All glory to him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by shedding his blood for us. He has made us a kingdom of priests for God his Father. All glory and power to him forever and ever. Amen. Verse 7. Look, he comes with the clouds of heaven, and everyone will see him, even those who pierced him, and all the nations of the world will mourn for him. Yes, amen. Verse 8. I am the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, says the Lord God. And he's going to repeat a phrase he repeated. He wrote just a few verses earlier. I am the one, this is God, I am the one who is, who always was, and who is still to come. To me, that's one of the most comforting phrases in all of Scripture. Right? To know that nothing that happens is a surprise to God. The God has always been there. He's with these seven churches here in Revelation as they're walking through persecution. He's with us today as we walk through this pandemic. And he's going to be with churches in the future, whatever it is that they experience in terms of persecution. He is the one who is, who always was, and who is to come, the Almighty One. So I, John, verse 9, I, John, am your brother, your partner in suffering, right? Guys, you're not alone in this. He's writing these churches saying, guys, you're suffering, I'm suffering. I'm on an island. I've been banished. I can't even see people. I'm on this barren island. And I was placed here for preaching the word of God and for my testimony about Jesus. But guess what? Right? Jesus showed up. It was the Lord's day, and I was worshiping in the Spirit, and suddenly I heard behind me a loud voice like a trumpet blast. And it said, write in a book everything you see and send it to the seven churches in the cities of Ephesus and Smyrna and Pergamum and Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, and finally Laodicea. So these seven churches that John is writing to and that we're going to study, they're located in the Roman province of Asia Minor, what is now, what is today modern Turkey. And these seven churches were chosen because they were located in key cities of what we might call the seven postal districts into which Asia Minor was divided. In fact, there's a map that hopefully is up on the screen, and so you can kind of see how these seven churches are laid out. And so if you wanted to communicate, what a messenger would do is he would start in Ephesus. Okay, he would land there at the port of Ephesus, and then he would just kind of go in a clockwise manner. He'd go to Ephesus and then on to Smyrna and Pergamum and, you know, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia. He'd work his way south, ending at Laodicea. Right? And so as we dive into these individual letters, one thing I want us also to understand is that as these letters were delivered to these seven churches in this clockwise manner, as things were communicated, each church heard all seven letters. It wasn't like Ephesus only heard the letter to them, and Smyrna only heard the letter to them, and you know, Pergamum only heard the letter to them. Each church heard all the letters, because it's actually the entire book of Revelation was delivered, so they heard it all at one time. And so these seven letters are not just letters to a church. These seven letters are letters to the entire church. The church that was, the church that is, again, and the church that is to come. That's why I believe that these letters are so practical for today. Because they were written for today. Because, you know, even though times have changed, the church in terms of how we're persecuted and the struggles that we have not changed. Right? The false doctrine, false teachers, losing focus, persecution, all that has continued throughout the beginning of the church. And so that's what makes these letters so appropriate for such a time as this. And as we'll see, right, all the letters really contain the same, pretty much the same, they're laid out the same, right? Almost all the letters contain a commendation, right? Here's what you guys do well, but here's one concern I have, and here's how you can correct that, and here's what I'm going to call you to do and challenge you to do, because this is how you can continue to be a light in the city that God has placed you in. So kind of with all that as a background, we're going to start with this letter to the church in Ephesus. And really, for me, what sticks out most about the church in Ephesus is it's the only church I know of in the Bible that we can actually read about its birth, its life, and its death. And so this morning, I want to focus on those two bookends. I want to look at the birth of the church of Ephesus and ask the question, okay, how was it so successful? What was it that just launched this church to be such a prominent church, especially in the beginning? And then because of that, what happened? Okay? How can a church that was so powerful and had such an amazing influence in the beginning, how can it all of a sudden cease to exist? How does it all of a sudden close its doors? What can we learn from a church that had far more explosive growth and far more Holy Spirit power than anything we've ever seen? And yet, it got confused. It drifted. And it ultimately disappeared. So to look at the birth, we've got to go back to the book of Acts. So you maybe keep your finger there in Revelation 2, but go with me to the book of Acts, which is really where the majority of church history, at least from the beginning, is recorded. And we're going to specifically go to Acts chapter 19. Acts chapter 19. If you turn there, let me again give you a little bit of thoughts on Ephesus. What's going on? What's so great about the city of Ephesus? Well, although Ephesus was not the capital of Asia Minor, that title went to Pergamum, Ephesus was generally regarded as the most important of these seven cities. One is because it was strategically located at the junction of four of the most important Roman roads in Asia Minor. And then, of course, it was a port city. So given that it was at this intersection of these main roads, which allowed a lot of influential people to travel through Ephesus, and given the fact that it was a port city, it was really the center of the Asian Minor market here in the first century. So for me, this makes Ephesus really a perfect place to plant one of the first churches from scratch, and that's exactly what Paul did. So again, here in Acts 19, we're going to start at verse 1. While Paulus was in Corinth, Paul traveled through the interior regions until he reached Ephesus on the coast, where he found several believers, right? So he finds these people, and we're going to find out in just a moment, that they're called believers, but they really have no understanding of what it means to believe or to follow Jesus. Or, you know, what's that all about? Verse 2. And so Paul's going to ask them a question. He's going to try to figure out, okay, where are they in their faith? So he asks this question. Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed? He asked them, right? That Paul's going all the way back to Pentecost, saying, okay, true believers, they've been baptized in the Holy Spirit, right? They've received the Holy Spirit. That's when we know that you are a true follower of Jesus. That's how we kind of separate the false teachers from the true followers. No, they replied. We haven't even heard, right? They hadn't even heard that there was a Holy Spirit. Paul's going to ask the question, then what baptism did you experience? And they replied, the baptism of John. Paul said, John's baptism called for repentance of sin. So, you've done a great job because you've acknowledged. You've acknowledged that you're a sinner. You've acknowledged that you fall short of God's standard. You've acknowledged that you have sin in your life. So you're good there, but there's something you're missing. Because John himself, here at the end of verse 4, John himself told the people to believe in the one who would come later, meaning Jesus. Verse 5, as soon as they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus, right? Because they're all in, right? Okay, Paul, if that's what you say we got to do to be a complete follower of Jesus, we're all in. So we're ready to be baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Then, when Paul laid hands on them, the Holy Spirit came on them, and they spoke in other tongues and they prophesied. And there were about 12 men in all, right? So Paul's going to launch this church on the foundation, on the backbone of these 12 men who are still trying to figure out what it means to be a follower of Jesus. So he's going to spend the next 3 months preaching in the synagogue. He's going to continue to preach the gospel because these men need to, you know, they're still in training. They're still trying to figure it all out. And so then after those 3 months, he's going to go on. He's going to preach another 2 years at a lecture hall in Ephesus. And because of his preaching, we'll read it a little bit farther down here in Acts 19, that people all throughout the province of Asia, both Jews and Greeks, heard the word of the Lord. In fact, already, I mean, Ephesus, the church here, it's barely started. It's barely launched. They don't even have a building yet. But yet they've already impacted well beyond the city of Ephesus. It's already reached, you know, Smyrna and Pergamum and Thyatira. It's already reached, you know, most of Asia Minor. Now listen to what happens next. Drop down to verse 11. So God gave Paul the power to perform unusual miracles. And here's one, right? When handkerchiefs or aprons that had merely touched his skin were placed on sick people, they were healed of their diseases and evil spirits were expelled. In fact, a group of Jews were traveling from town to town casting out evil spirits. And they tried to use the name of the Lord Jesus in their incantation, saying, I command you, in the name of Jesus, whom Paul preaches, to come out. Seven sons of Sceva, a leading priest, were doing this. But one time they tried it. And the evil spirit replied, I know Jesus. I know Paul. But who are you? Right? Just think about that for a second, right? You're casting out this demon and you're fervently crying out on the name, you know, in the name of Jesus, spirit come out, leave this guy. And the spirit basically looks at you and says, I get Jesus, I get Paul. I have no clue who you are. Then the man with the evil spirit leaped at them, overpowered them, and attacked them with such violence that they fled from the house naked and battered. I mean, that right there says, you know what? Just because you appear to be religious and you may say the right things and you may do the right things, if you don't have the power of the Holy Spirit, it's not going to work. Your ministry is not going to be effective. You have got to do ministry in the power of the Holy Spirit. And then verse 17. So the story of what happened spread quickly all through Ephesus to Jews and Greeks alike. And a solemn fear descended on the city, and the name of the Lord Jesus was greatly honored. Drop down to we'll keep reading. And many who became believers confessed their sinful practices, and a number of them who had been practicing sorcery brought their incantation books, and they burned them at a public bonfire. And the value of the books, get this, was several million dollars. So now people are just, they're coming from everywhere. Because they hear what Paul's doing and they're watching these miracles and they saw what happened with the other priests who didn't have the Holy Spirit and how that turned out for them. And so they're saying, okay, there's something to this Jesus stuff, right? So they come and they repent and they confess and they give up their sorcery that they've been doing, their incantation books. Verse 20, so the message of the Lord spread widely and had a powerful effect. And then drop down to verse 23. And about that time, serious trouble developed in Ephesus concerning the way, which is what Christians were called there in the beginning. It began with Demetrius, a silversmith, who had a large business manufacturing silver shrines of the Greek goddess Artemis. And he kept many craftsmen busy. And he called them together, along with others employed in similar trades, and he addressed them as follows. Gentlemen, you know that our wealth comes from this business. In other words, guys, we're going to go broke here if we don't do something. But as you have seen and heard, this man Paul has persuaded many people that handmade gods aren't really gods at all. And he's done this not only here in Ephesus, but throughout the entire province, right? Throughout all of Asia Minor. Of course, I'm not just talking about the loss of public respect for our business. I'm also concerned that the temple of the great goddess Artemis will lose its influence, and that Artemis, this magnificent goddess worshipped throughout the province of Asia and all around the world, will be robbed of her great prestige. So let me stop there. I mean, think about this. Think about this with me for a second. Where have you read? Have you read anywhere in church history where a single church is solely responsible for turning an entire social, economic, as well as religious climate on its head, simply by preaching the gospel. Because that's all they did. They preached the gospel, they performed some miracles, and all of a sudden, the entire economy is in danger because it's based around this false god Artemis. And which is gonna also turn upside down the religious system, right? Let me try to explain it like this. It would be the equivalent. What we read here, it'd be the equivalent of a missionary going to Vegas, going to Las Vegas, and laying on the strip, and he just starts walking up and down the strip, and he's preaching the gospel, which I know happens on the strip, but let's assume this is like legit, right? So he's preaching the gospel, and people start to listen. They're paying attention. In fact, they're getting saved. They're coming to Jesus, and they're starting to preach. And more people get saved. And then people are starting to repent, right, of their sins, and they're quitting their jobs at the strip clubs, and they're no longer prostitutes. And so all of a sudden, the whole economic society known as Sin City, known as Las Vegas, has been turned upside down. Can you just imagine? Imagine what that would do here in the Northwest if that happened. If one church all of a sudden started preaching the gospel, and all of a sudden people started coming out of the woodwork, and our city, our economic society was just turned upside down because so many people were coming to Jesus. That's what's happening here. That's what is happening here. This is the kind of impact that the Church of Ephesus was having in the early days of her ministry. And as we know, it didn't stop there. Because there's so much written. I mean, we could spend weeks on this church. There's so much written throughout the pages of the New Testament to and about this church. And because of that, it makes you wonder, okay, what went wrong? What went wrong? Because as you read the book of Ephesians and 1st and 2nd Timothy and even 1st through 3rd John, there aren't many warning signs. There's a couple things that make you, stop and think. But there's really nothing major. There's really no huge red flags where you stop and think, man, okay, this church is headed for disaster, right? This church is in real trouble. And then we get to Revelation chapter 2, and John's gonna let us know, okay, this church may look good on the outside, but it's in trouble. It's in real trouble. So back to Revelation chapter 2, starting at verse 2. He writes this, and he's writing this letter to the church in Ephesus. I know all the things you do. I've seen your hard work, right? I know everything you do. I've seen it, right? It's there for everyone to see. I've seen your hard work, your patient endurance. I know you don't tolerate evil people. You've examined the claims of those who say they're apostles but are not. You've discovered they are liars. You have patiently suffered for me without quitting. Now again, if we stop there, everything looks great on the surface. Because the church in Ephesus, it's working hard in the face of continuous persecution. They're enduring patiently during these tough times. They've even maintained a solid theology, using that theology to combat false teaching and false doctrine. Right? So everything looks good. And then all of a sudden we get to verse 4. But, right, John writes, but I have this complaint against you. How many times have you been a part of that kind of conversation? Where someone comes and says, hey, I appreciate, or, you doing this, or, hey, this restaurant, you need to go eat there, or, man, this was a great movie, and you're all ready to go, you're all ready to sign up, you're ready to go all in, and all of a sudden, he says, yeah, but. Right, but. And that's exactly what happened here in Revelation 2. John started by, giving them commendation. Jesus says, hey, here's some great things you're doing. But. Right? I have this one thing against you. In fact, complaint, verse 4. But I have this complaint against you. You don't love me or each other as you did at first. Right? Ouch. Okay? Jesus looks at him and says, you don't love me. You don't love me. Look how far you have fallen. Turn back to me and do the works you did at first. If you don't repent, I will come and remove your lampstand from its place among the churches. Now understand this, okay? When Jesus says you don't love me like you used to, okay? He's saying something that really carries a lot of weight with the church in Ephesus, because they were known as a church that loved God. In fact, 35 years earlier. Paul actually commended the church in Ephesus on their love. Let me just read it. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 15. Paul says, "Ever since I first heard of your strong faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for God's people everywhere, I've not stopped thanking God for you. I pray for you constantly." Why? Because I've heard about your strong faith, right? And your love. I've heard about your love. And so it took 35 years. It took trials that didn't make sense. It took questions that didn't get answered. It took a loss of health and hope for them to basically sequester themselves and to say, and to take their eyes off of Jesus and to focus on the internal, to focus on the church itself, on the programs, on what they knew they could do well, right? Which was to stay busy. That's all they knew. They finally said, okay, you know what? We just need to stay busy. Because if we don't stay busy, then we will cease to exist. That was their thinking. And now Jesus says, again, 35 years of them being busy, Jesus says, you know what? You've lost it. You've lost your love for me. And it's not enough. It's not enough to just go through the motions. Because Jesus wanted more than their good works and their good theology. Which brings up the question, okay, what was it that they did at first, right? Because John says that. He says, look how far you have fallen. In other words, remember what it was, how you were in the beginning. And we read about it in Acts 19, right? I'm just going to go back there briefly. You don't need to turn back there. I just want to go back there just to kind of remind us what we had just read. What was it like for the church in Ephesus in the beginning? In the beginning, God gave Paul the power to perform unusual miracles, right? He was healing people, and so much was happening. People were drawn to these healings. They were drawn to the message of Jesus. And even other religions, again, as I talked about, were wanting a piece of the action. They were wanting to get their cut of the miracles that were happening and the people that were coming to faith. Verse 17, and this story of what happened spread quickly all through Ephesus to the Jews and Greeks alike. And listen to this next part. A solemn fear descended on the city. A holy fear. A holy respect for God descended on the city. And the name of the Lord Jesus was greatly honored. Right? So what did they do in the beginning? They honored Jesus. They had a healthy fear and respect for God and his son, Jesus. And then they also repented of their sin. Right? The next part says, many who became believers confessed their sinful practices, and right, they brought their sorcery books and they burned them, right? They gave up their business. They gave up how they earned their living in order to follow Jesus. That's what they did at first. That is the foundation on which the Church of Ephesus was built. It was built on a healthy respect and fear and love for God and for right living. Well, again, the Church of Ephesus, it experienced the kind of honeymoon period that today would be, it would be required reading for any pastor who thinks of planting a church, right? Because as I mentioned earlier, it was planted in a highly influential city with all the amenities of a Portland or a Los Angeles or a New York, right? And it was built on a foundation of love and honor and respect for God, right? It was built on the Great Commandment and the Great Commission. For 30 years, it wasn't just a church in Ephesus, it was the church in Ephesus. But the loss of a vital love relationship with Jesus opened the doors for spiritual apathy, for indifference to others, for really a laser-focused busyness that became a substitute for intimacy with Christ. And so Jesus sends a warning to this once prominent church. Remember, repent. And then finally, return to me, right? Look how far you have fallen, verse 5. Turn back to me and do the works you did at first. Because if you don't repent, I will come and remove your lampstand from its place among the churches, right? I will remove your ability to point others to Jesus. I will remove your influence. And so what does all this have to do with us here at Parkside? Well, for a church that's been closed as long as we have, there's a danger. there's a real danger that when we open back up, that we don't open up with the right focus. We could fall into a trap where we're simply excited just to be together, right? We're excited to be able to hang out and do churchy things, right? We get to sing together. We get to study God's word together. We get to eat donuts together. We get to have lunch together, right? We get to talk in the lobby together, right? We're excited to do church stuff. And so I've said this before. I often wonder if COVID is actually a blessing in disguise, because it really has forced churches to clear the calendar, to clear the template on how church services are supposed to go and how we grow spiritually. It really has cleared the deck in that sense, and it's forced us as pastors to really ask the question, okay, how can I help my congregation? How can I help my congregation as individuals fall more in love with Jesus during this time of self-isolation? Because I know how to do it when we were together. I mean, I've gone to school for this. I know exactly how to help people grow spiritually in a corporate setting, right? I mean, I've taken tons of classes on that, church growth classes. But how do I help someone grow spiritually in the midst of self-isolation? And really, it boils down to this. It boils down to the individual. It boils down to that individual making a commitment to fall in love with Jesus every single day. And this goes back to the spiritual disciplines that we've talked about so often. It really is us, me as a pastor, and Roger, it's us giving you the tools. Whatever it is that will help you grow spiritually, and only you know what that is, because it's different for every person. Whether it's a time of solitude, whether it's Bible study, whether it's listening to music, writing in your journal, times of celebration, times of serving, whatever it looks like. It's us equipping you to be able to do that on your own, understanding that falling in love with Jesus, again, is a daily occurrence, not a once-a-week occurrence. Sunday shouldn't be the only time we fall in love with Jesus. Every morning when we wake up, we need to make a commitment that today I'm going to fall in love with Jesus. And when I go to bed tonight, I'm going to love Jesus more than I did when I woke up. And I'm going to love Jesus more than I did yesterday. That should be the goal. The challenge Jesus gave to the church of Ephesus is to keep first things first, which is our love for Jesus. We've got to pursue Jesus above everyone and everything. And that's my commitment. As we open up, we will open up with Jesus as the main thing. Notice the contrast here. Notice the contrast between the commendations in verses 2 and 3, because those are all external commendations, right? I see how hard you work. I see how hard you study theology. I see how hard you examine things and confront things, right? You're good there. And then he goes to the commendations, which are internal. He says, yeah, you look great on the outside, but on the inside, you're lost. On the inside, you've lost your love. On the inside, you're dead. Jesus is saying, hey, you're doing all this stuff. You've got some solid bricks in the foundation of your spiritual life, but you're missing the most important piece. You're missing the cornerstone, which is Jesus. C.S. Lewis wrote this. He said, every Christian would agree that a man's spiritual health is exactly proportional to his love for God. And I think the same is true for the local church, that Our health as a church is exactly proportional to our love for God. Our spiritual health is not based on how many people come. It's not based on how much Bible we learn. It's not based on anything that we think is important. Our spiritual health is based solely on our love for God. And so as we reopen our doors, our priority has got to be Jesus. As we gather together again, I don't want us to embrace each other. I don't want us to embrace each other, and not because the social distancing guidelines say we can't, right? I don't want us to embrace each other because I'd rather we embrace Christ. To treasure being in His presence, not the presence of each other. To find our joy not in being together, but to find our joy because we are together in the presence of Jesus. right? Everything has got to point to Jesus, because if we don't, Jesus says, I will remove your lampstand. He will remove our light, and we will cease to shine. Well, John closes with an incredible promise to these, I don't think the church in Ephesus, but actually to all the other six churches and us as well. He closes with this promise. Anyone who hears, anyone with ears to hear, must listen to the Spirit and understand what he is saying to the churches. To everyone who is victorious, in other words, to everyone who does these things, to everyone who keeps the main thing, to everyone who continues to love God and love others, I will give fruit from the tree of life in the paradise of God. The tree of life in the paradise of God. This specific promise, with this specific promise, John is referring back to Genesis, tying together the all but forgotten original creation with the always longed for new creation. Because this fruit from the tree of life is the same tree that stood in the midst of the Garden of Eden. And it's the same tree that John's going to write about in the last chapter of Revelation, Revelation 22, where Jesus is going to remind us that those who believe in him have the right to eat from the tree of life when we are together with Jesus in heaven, in paradise. Because that's the future. That's the future that we all long for, isn't it? We all long to be together with Jesus in heaven. And so right now, we should also long to be together with Jesus in our church, right? We should not just long to be together, but we should long to be together with Jesus. So this future is what should keep us laser focused on two things. And I'm going to sound like a broken record, but to me, it's what's most important. It's loving God and loving others. That was the charge. That was the challenge here to the church in Ephesus, is to somehow return to your first love. Somehow put aside your church calendars and once again fall in love with your Savior. Once again fall in love with your Heavenly Father. Well, next week Norm's going to continue. He's going to unpack for us the letter to the church in Smyrna. I'm excited to hear from Pastor Norm. But as we close this morning, I want to give you an opportunity to spend some time falling in love with Jesus, because so often in church life, especially on a Sunday morning, you hear a message, the pastor closes in prayer, maybe we sing a song, and then you're out the door and you're on to the rest of your day. And now's the perfect time, because you can't just go because you're stuck at home, right? I want you to take advantage of that. I want you to spend some time reacquainting yourself with your Heavenly Father, falling in love with your Savior Jesus. So we're going to play a song. It's called Revelation Song. And this song uses a phrase that John used in the first chapter, where God says, I am the one who is. I am the one who is, who always was, and who is still to come. So this song is going to repeat that phrase. And again, that's a phrase of comfort. That's a phrase that should bring us comfort and should draw us closer to Jesus. So spend these next few moments committing yourselves to this week. Say, this week I'm gonna commit myself to falling in love with Jesus more than I loved Jesus the day before. And allow that love to just grow and to drive you. Pursue the love for Jesus as much as the love of Jesus has pursued us. Let me close this in prayer. God, again, I thank you for your love for us. That love that drove you to send your son Jesus. God, you've been pursuing us every single day. You pursue us every single minute. And so now, God, I ask that you would help us to turn that around and to pursue our love for you. That our love for you would just drive us into your arms. God, I thank you for this church. God, I thank you for the influence that you've allowed us to have throughout 60 some odd years that Parkside has been here. God, I pray that our lamp would shine brighter. That as we reopen, God, that you would use us to point people to Jesus. That people would look at Parkside and they would see you. That they would see the light, which is your son, Jesus. God, just thank you for the time that we have to be together, even through a TV screen. God, I can't wait for the day when we get to be together again in your presence. Lord, I love you. I pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Thanks, Parkside. Be sure and make it a priority to be back next week as Pastor Norm will be talking about the letter to the church in Smyrna. Enjoy the rest of your Sunday.